So one of the wonderful things about depth-first search is that it can be implemented really straightforwardly with recursion, which makes it very easy to read and pretty easy to reason about. Not so with breadth-first search. Breadth-first search is going to require a little bit more care to implement it in a way that keeps track of things in the right order. So as a step towards being able to do that, let's redo depth-first search just the way it was done before, but this time without recursion. And what we're going to do, the way that we're going to actually make that work, is by introducing a new data structure called the open list. And the open list, I like to think of it as a kind of a to-do list because it keeps track of what it is I need to do next. And essentially, I'm a slave to my to-do list. I've actually had students occasionally add things to my to-do list because I wouldn't know that I wasn't supposed to do them, and they get me to do things that I'm not supposed to do. So I would not encourage you to be quite so short-sighted, but algorithms actually are going to be that short-sighted. And so this open list is going to help the algorithm keep track of what needs to get done. So here's how we're going to do it. We're going to start all the nodes as unmarked, so they're all just nice open blue circles. And we're going to put P onto the open list, and we're going to follow this procedure here. And the procedure says, go to the to-do list, get the thing at the end of the list that has to get done, and do it. The way that we're going to do it is we pull it off the list, then we go to all the neighbors of the node that we're working on, which is P, and any that are unmarked, we do two things to them. We mark them, and we add them to the open list. So the neighbors of P, in this case, are R, S, and Q. So we're going to add R, S, and Q to the open list and mark them all as visited. Now we're done that process, and we go back to the beginning and do it again. We take the ending little piece off the to-do list and say, oh, Q, that's what we have to do. Go to the graph, find all the neighbors of Q, in this case just T, mark it, add it to the to-do list. Okay, we're done. No, we're not. We have to go back to the beginning and do it again. Grab the top thing off the to-do list, which is the T, check all its neighbors, Q and U. Only one of them hasn't been visited, and that's U. We mark it, add it to the to-do list. And we repeat again. Grab the last thing off the to-do list, which is U. Look at all the neighbors of U, which are R, S, and T. They've all been marked. Nothing to do. Yes, there is. There's still one more thing on the to-do list. We have to get the S. Take the S off the list. Check all the neighbors of S. U, R, P, Q. They've all been visited, so we don't add anything new to the to-do list. We finish that iteration. Go back to the top. One more thing on the to-do list, R. Check R. R has three neighbors, P, S, and U. All of them have been marked. We add nothing to the to-do list, to the open list. We see that there's nothing left open, and now we're really done. Ta-da! This procedure here performs just like depth-first search. It goes through and it adds nodes in an order that has to do with diving deeper and deeper into the graph. But it does it without any recursion. Instead of recursion, it just has this open list to keep track of things. All right, here's another graph that we're going to search, and this is going to help us illustrate the difference between depth-first search and breadth-first search. So what we're going to do is we're going to start a search from V, and let's see how it proceeds. So we start off V, we mark V, and our instructions again say that we look at all the neighbors of V, W and Z, mark the unmarked ones, after we've removed V from the list, mark the unmarked ones, add the unmarked ones to our open list. Now we take the first thing off the open list, which is the Z, and repeat. V is already marked, Y is not. We add Y to our open list. Now we work on Y again. We're always working on the most recent thing. Y says we have to check X and Z. Those are the neighbors. Z's already been marked. X is not. Take care of X. And then just as before, now that everything's marked, it's going to end up popping things off the open list and it finishes. But let's look at the order in which nodes were marked. This was marked first, then this, then this, then this, then this. Mostly the flow is in the order of deeper and deeper and deeper.